Our God is a good God, amen? The wonderful thing about it, the scripture that Nikkei read this morning says this, it says, the righteous might face many troubles, but the Lord will carry him and bring him through and give him victory over each and every one of them. I said to the guys this morning, I said, sometimes we trust that no trouble will come our way. Now, hear me right. Obviously, none of us are signing up for trouble. You know, please send trouble my way. No. But because we are focused sometimes at the wrong place, we're saying, Lord, just I'm trusting you that I won't have any troubles. God is saying the righteous will have a little trouble, many troubles. It's not something you want to hear. But he says, but the Lord will give you victory over all of them. He will give you victory over all of them. So hold on to that this morning, that if you are in a season of challenge, if you see the troubles running your way and the storms welling up next to you, know this, that you don't only have to trust that God will calm the storm. But keep your eyes on Him, because no matter what the storm does, your victory is secure in Him. Amen? He will carry you through. Now, we are in the book of Hebrews. For those of you that have been journeying with us in the book of Hebrews this morning, actually, I almost want to call it a gear shift. Now, the writer of Hebrews, in the first nine chapters, and actually the first portion of chapter 10 as well, it's all about instruction. It's all about teaching this little storm-tossed congregation, this congregation that is going through so many trials and challenges and tribulations at that time and full-blown persecution. The first portion of Hebrews up until chapter 9, he's very much teaching them about what it is that their victory is based on. He's giving them a lot of explanation about the superiority of the person and the work of Christ. But here in chapter 10, we actually see a bit of a gear shift with him going from instruction to application, saying to them, because of everything I've shared with you, Hebrews 1, 2, 3, 4, Jesus greater than Moses, greater than the heavenly beings, Him the highest authority, the greatness of Christ, the anchor for our soul, the fact that we are not surrendered just to an earthly high priest, but we have an heavenly high priest that now stands in for us, not in an earthly tabernacle, but in a heavenly tabernacle. There's so many truths, so many foundational things about our victory, about who we are, and especially who He is. And because of who He is, who we are in Him, that is explained and instructed and taught in chapters 1 to 9. And He now brings them to a point of application and saying, listen, because of that, I want to share this with you. Because that is the case. Because He is who He is. And He does what He does, and He did what He did, and He is doing what He is doing. Because of that, we now step into this portion where He starts instructing them, where He starts exhorting them. He actually moves to a point where He says, listen, this now you know, and because you know that, this is a reality. Now let me show that to you, if you can turn with me to Hebrews chapter 10. And we're going to read from verse 19. Just read the passage first, and then we'll come back and just open it up a little bit. And it's such a beautiful, powerful passage. Please turn to your neighbor and just say, don't miss this. Don't miss this. A gear change you shouldn't miss. That's the exhilarating part of a drive. Isn't it so? When there's a gear change and everything kicks in, you understand, is that why? Is this what happens when I understand that? Now, read with me. Chapter 10, verse 19 says this. It says, therefore, brothers and sisters, Since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Christ, or by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is His body. And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for He who promised is faithful. Verse 24, and let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. So this transition from instruction to application, this transition from saying to the sharing with them, listen, I know things are tough, but because of these realities, because there's so much more, I want to share this with you. And that's why I'm starting a sermon this morning with therefore, but you know there's 9 chapters before this, right? Let me just quickly remind you of these 9 chapters, actually summed up pretty well in this last portion of chapter 9. He says, for by one sacrifice in verse 14, for by one sacrifice He has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Not continual sacrifice, one sacrifice. He, who is He? Christ, our high priest. He has made us what? He says He's made perfect. So we are made perfect. You say, but I'm not, Peter, I don't feel perfect. No, you see, He says you're being made perfect forever who are being made holy. We are being made holy, but the perfection is already there because it's not in us, it's in Christ. It's in Him. And then the last verse in chapter 10, verse 18, just before the verse we read, it says, and where these have been forgiven, sacrifice for sin is no longer necessary. There's no sacrifice necessary because the sacrifice is a sacrifice that was paid once and for all, and it is complete. There's no sacrifice necessary because of what He has done and because of who it is that has made the sacrifice. Now, with that in mind, with a heavenly tabernacle in mind, with an earthly ark of the covenant, with a heavenly inside in mind, knowing that we now carry as royal priests, as a holy nation, we now carry His law in our hearts, in our minds, knowing that it's not something we've got to go and look for. Knowing that this, the writer of Hebrews, this pastor to this congregation is pastoring them through this letter and saying to them, therefore, brothers and sisters, verse 19, since we have confidence. What confidence? He's not saying since we hope now. No, he's saying since we have confidence of what? Since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is His body. The curtain that is His body. So he's saying, listen, there is confidence. Because of all of this, we now have confidence. We are bold in what we know. What do we know? We know. And this first issue that gives us boldness, this first bit of truth that he wants to remind us of here is the truth of access. He says we are, because we know this, we know what? We know that we can enter the most holy place. We can enter the presence of God Himself. That was not the case before this, but we now know, because we know this, we can enter. Why can we enter? It's in the verse. We can enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus. Verse 19, verse 20, by a new and living way opened for us through what? Through the curtain. And then he says this, that is His body. So Christ Jesus is our access. Our confidence comes from the fact that there is no more curtain, because in Christ Jesus, the curtain was torn and the access was granted. Your access into the most holy place, your access into the presence of God is not you or what you have done. It is Christ. Would you hear me say this again? Our access is Christ. It's not just because of Christ. Our access is Him. Say, Piet, aren't you taking it a bit further? No, he says, through the curtain that is Christ. Jesus is our entry. Where there was a division between holy and most holy, there is no division anymore, because Jesus represented that curtain and tore it from top to bottom forever. It can never be restored. Our access is Christ. So they can now walk confidently through the torn curtain that is Christ, so to speak, into the presence of the Father, because now He is within us. But listen to this. Before the time, they could not have done that, because only one person could have done it once a year. But now we have access always. Our access is unrestricted. I almost want to say it's like a backstage pass. You see, if you buy tickets to any kind of event, you get an area where you can go, right? But your entrance through Christ Jesus into the most holy of holies, into the presence of God, is unrestricted access, because He is our access. And it is not just now, it is forever. He says, because we know this. In chapter 4, you can go back a few weeks in this. In chapter 4, we talked about the fact that he said this. He said, let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence. Here he says, therefore, because we have confidence. Why do we have confidence? Because we know. We know who he is. We know where the temple, what the temple is. We know that it's heavenly. We know that it's because of him and not us. We know his laws in our hearts. We know that we are set free forever. Because of that, Hebrews chapter 4 says, let us approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. But more than that, we are not just confident because of our access, we're also confident because He is our advocate. Okay, some of you are looking at me like, okay, Piet, all right, let me quickly just go back. It seems you've forgotten. In the old paradigm, in the old covenant, you had the high priest and the curtain. The curtain restricted the access. The high priest went in once a year. In the new covenant, Christ is both the curtain and the high priest. He is the access and the advocate. Let me show you this. In the Old Testament, the high priest had to wear a breastplate with stones on the breastplate, representing to represent the people, so that when he stood before God, he would represent Israel. And on his shoulders was representative stones as well, so that he's not just standing there for himself, he's standing there representing the people. That's the old covenant. The new covenant, which we now have access to the Father, an access that is unrestricted. We have a high priest that do not just have a breastplate with stones that represent us. He does not just, he's not just carrying a representation of us or representing us on the outside. He's carrying us within himself. He's not just saying, I'm here on behalf of them. He's saying, I'm standing here instead of them. There's a difference. Isaiah prophesied this. He said, and he numbered himself with the transgressors. The image being painted is this. He did not say, listen, look at the row of sinners, I'm standing in for them. No, he got in the line himself and said, come on guys, you don't have to stand. If you are in me, I'll stand in the line of sinners in your stead, and I'll pay the price for you. What an advocate. You see, we live as if he's just standing in for us. He's carrying us somewhere on a breastplate saying, I'm just representing them. No, he's standing in, he's saying, I'm standing in their stead. This is the kind of advocate God gave us in his son, Jesus Christ. Sitting at the right hand of the Father, being both our access and our advocate. Come on, you've got to grasp this. You've got to grab hold of this. For 9 chapters, he's been leading us. He's been building us in. He's been showing us what happened and what is happening, the old and the new, the old and the new. And now he's saying, because you now know that you are not in the old anymore, it's not old promises, it's not an old tabernacle, it's not an old temple, it is not an old high priest, it is a new high priest, it's a new tabernacle, it's a new temple, it's sovereign in its nature, it's spiritual in its character, and it brings freedom forever through Jesus Christ, and nothing will change that. He says, because you are bold, you're bold in that faith. You know this because of this. Jesus is both the curtain, the access, and he's the priest, the advocate. Man, God put together a beautiful new covenant. Beautiful new promises. Let me share with you how Paul describes it. Maybe then we can verbalize it in a more... shall I say modern way? Although I think the modern way is a bit skewed, but let's read what Paul says. Paul says in Romans chapter 8, he says, Romans chapter 8 from verse 31 to 34 says, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also along with him graciously give us all things? And then he asks the question, he says, who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? It is Christ who died, more than that, who is raised to life and is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. So Paul says, my confidence is in the fact that if God set me free, who is condemning me? If he's the one that has set me free and given me my freedom, who is the one that is condemning me again? Is it me? Is it others? And what is their authority compared to his authority? And because he's the highest authority, would we stand in the new and would be like he's writing here to the Hebrews, he's saying, listen, therefore you know this and now be bold because of this. It basically means, brothers and sisters, listen to me, it means that we are victors. You are more than conquerors through what Jesus Christ did. Now we may be defeated for a moment, but evil will never prevail. You may have challenges for a moment, but he will carry you through all of them. What boldness, what confidence does this access and his advocacy bring in us? Now he says, okay, because you know this, and by New Living Way, you now know that he is open through the curtain. We've got this access. And since we have a great high priest in the house of God, now he gives us 3 things that we need to do. And I want to pause with this morning and follow these 3 things with me. And I'm going to read it to you just as he gives it from verse 22. He says, now we have access. We have this advocate for us. We have this confidence because of all of this. What should we do? And this is where he's moving into the application part. He's saying to them, because of this, now let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with full assurance that faith brings. Having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us draw near to God. If we want to know why we're so bold, the verse just before that said, because of this new and living way, because we have access to the holy place, because he's our advocate, therefore we draw near to God. We draw near to God in this new covenant because we are confident about who he is. Here in this in the verse, he says it this way. He says, with having full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. In the old covenant, in the old way, you can only be cleansed from your sins and just temporary. But your conscience remains. Because you would stand there with the sacrifice and wonder, is the sacrifice good enough? But in the new, this new confidence that we have in Christ Jesus, he says, we have confidence that faith brings, knowing that it even brings us to a place that removes not only our sins, but a guilty conscience. Some of you are looking at me now, that you can't say that. I'm not saying this. Let me read it to you again. Having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from what? To cleanse us from what? A guilty conscience. If we hold on to our guilty conscience, we will always be working in an effort to gain access, to be good enough for advocacy. But in Jesus Christ, we are not just set free from our sins. Your sins, you've not just found mercy, you have found his grace, his presence, his indwelling spirit that even sets you free from a guilty conscience, living like Paul wrote, living like Paul wrote in Romans, saying, listen, I know that I'm set free because he said so. He set me free. Yeah, but Peter, you know, you still do this or you still do that. He says, I'm free. Who are you? Hello? That's what Paul says. He says, if he says sets me free, who's the one that still comes and judges me? Yep. We are not called to be one another's judges. You're not even called to be your own judge. The Spirit of God will release and work the Word of God inside of you and remind you that your access is through Him. Your advocate is Him. Your freedom is in Christ. And Scripture says, he who's been set free in Christ has been set free indeed. Is that the truth? What does that change? It changes us from living from Sunday to Sunday and living in the week as those that are burdened with a conscience, just making it to the Connect group. Guys, you gotta pray for me. Please, I'm not gonna make it to Sunday, just carry me. Changes us to those that say, listen, I know I'm not good enough, but he's good enough, and he's the one that stood in my stead. I know I cannot enter, but I'm entering with boldness because he's the one that made the way for me to enter, and he's the one that gives me access. Hello? So Peter, are you reading a little bit too much into this? Listen to this. It says, having our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold then. So first of all, he says, let us draw near to God, knowing that our hearts are sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. And then, in this context, he's saying to them, then being baptized as an outward expression of what happened on the inside. He's saying the second thing. So firstly, let us draw near to God. Secondly, let us hold unswervingly, verse 23, to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Now, this is not a very difficult instruction or a verse to understand. The second instruction is to hold what? Hold unbendingly, unswervingly. Do not move to the left or to the right. Hold unswervingly to what? To the hope we profess. Why? You can just read it. Isn't it so? Why? Because? For he, guys, can you read this with me, please? I thought you'll get, I'll say it. Can you please read the second portion with me? For he who promised is faithful. Can we read it again? I think we can do better. For he who promised is faithful. Who's faithful? He. He's not saying you can hold on unswervingly to the hope you profess because you are faithful. You've got to get this. You have to get this. This is a congregation being persecuted. He's saying, listen, you can hold on to the hope you profess unswervingly because he is faithful. And let me ask you, when is that going to change? When will the second portion of verse 23 change where we cannot say that he who promised is faithful? When? Never. So because of that, when will my hope, when will my boldness in faith because of the hope I profess, when will that change or when will that be challenged? Never, because it's not in my faithfulness, but in his faithfulness. If we get this, we will see Christians, sons and daughters of God with strengths and weaknesses walk boldly into the throne room of God, knowing that they cannot do it by themselves, but knowing that he's done it already, that he's the access, he's the curtain. He tore the curtain from the very beginning, and he's our advocate, he's our high priest. Therefore, we can stand boldly in the throne room of God, knowing that he is within us and we are within him, because he that promised is faithful. He's faithful. So application number one, draw near to God. Think secondly, hold on. Hold on to what? To the faith we profess, because he that promised is faithful. Thirdly, verse 24. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. I'm so glad for this verse, because I just know that some of you, you love the word, we're saying, Lord, this guy's just, he's just too much of a jack-in-a-box there in front. You know, if you can just quiet him down, I will listen a bit better. Some of you are going, I love the word, but you know, this guy's a little bit, he's a little bit irritating in his positivity. He's a little bit of challenge to swallow. I mean, this guy is a bit, but you know what? He says here, he says, let us consider how we may spur one another on. Do you know what spur one another on means? That's a question. Do you know what spur one another on means? Spurs, do you know what a cowboy's? Well, you know a spur is that thing at the back of a cowboy boot. And then you just take the boot and you just, and the horse goes, okay, he means what he's saying. Isn't it so? Spur one another on. Encourage one another. Encourage one another to the point where you challenge one another. So not just holding on to the hope, but consider one another, spurring one another. How can I spur those around me on? How can I encourage them to what? Towards love and good deeds. I can only do that if they know who he is and they know who they are in him. Then I can say, let's go. This is what God says. Encourage one another to what? To love and good deeds. Say, I don't know. I don't know if this is worthwhile. It's worthwhile. But Peter, I'm struggling. Don't worry. You might not be faithful, but he is faithful. But I'm not going through a good season. Just remember, his season is always good. Do you think the Lord got up this morning and say, oh, another day. I think for him it's like a symphony. Sunrise, holding everything in place, watching us get up this morning, and then just as you go out, you're just changing the clouds a little bit and say, look at this. And you're going, oh. And he's saying, consider one another. Look at one another and see what. Think of what. How can I, how can we spur one another on towards love and good deeds? I think we've grown too adept with just pull me through. No problem. If you're going through struggles, pull one another through. But I think we've lost the art of spurring one another on towards love and good deeds. Come on, my brother. Come on, my sister. Yeah, with my storms. Yeah, but lift your eyes. But I'm struggling, but he's faithful. But you know what? You know, this part, this area, don't worry. He's paid the price for all of it. But when I pray, I don't know if he hears. You know, I'm struggling to press through, to break through. You don't have to break through. Jesus did that already. Hello? When I'm praying, I'm feeling that my prayers are just going to the ceiling. No, they're not. They're never just going to the ceiling. By the way, they never have to go that far. Keith got it. They never have to go that far. Because where is it, Keith? Yeah. God is here. And what is he saying? He's saying, hey, I'm your access. I'm your advocate. I am who I said I am. And because of that, you are who I say you are. So therefore, come boldly. Third one, spurring one another on. Listen to this. Towards love and good deeds. And then in verse 25, it says, not giving up meeting together. Ah, Piet, you know, I love the Lord, I love the Word, I just don't like His people. That's why I do my church by myself. So you practice your patience also with yourself, right? Your love, your long-suffering, those fruits that the Spirit speaks of, you practice that there in your living room. Oh, I'm so patient with myself, you know. I make myself suffer and I'm actually learning myself long-suffering. You see, together we spur one another on and we encourage one another. As we see the day approaching. Can you see the days approaching? Can you? Can you see the days approaching? You know, if I look at across our season and I look at the messages coming through and the stuff that comes through over and over and over again, I see people see the days approaching. But I don't see them spurring one another on because of it. I see more of people sowing fear into one another's hearts because the day is approaching. What are we going to do? What about this? What about that? Let me ask you, what about him? Did he change? If the day is approaching, spur one another on towards what? Towards love and good deeds. And to do what? Spurring, encouraging one another on. To meet, to do what? To meet together. I almost want to say it's not rocket science, but meet together. How can you encourage one another if you don't meet together? Oh, I send a text. I post my stuff on Facebook. spurring one another on spiritually. I'm not saying you can't encourage one another over the phone, but let me say this to you. Discipleship, encouragement, spurring one another on happens in relationship. Very practical sermon. Now, it is in chapter 10, yes? This is our next chapter, yes? What I shared with you this morning is in Scripture, yes? So let's then just do what it says. This is who He is. Because we know that, we will hold on to our faith. We will boldly enter the throne of grace. Enter the Holy of Holies. God indwelling in our spirit, we are in Him and He's in us. And we will hold on because why? Because He's faithful. And we will encourage one another to gather together, not neglecting like some are in the habit of doing. I know I'm sharing this with you. I know that's not something that we do, but if you meet people that sometimes are in the habit of not coming together, you can share it with them. I know it's not something that we struggle with. But encourage one another not to neglect to come together. And all the more as we see the day approaching. Amen. Christians, God's people, this little congregation that is spoken to in Hebrews, the Hebrew writer says, live boldly. Know who you are. Know who He is and what He's done. Encourage one another. I'm going to ask Lisa to come forward. I'm going to pray together that the Lord will help us to take these three things because of the knowledge we have, to truly hold on to Him, draw near to Him, hold on to our faith because He is faithful, and to consider how we can encourage one another, spur one another on. So, Father, I pray for myself as I pray for those that are here this morning with me, each and every one of my brothers and sisters. I pray, Lord, that You would help us as we know and as since we have the confidence to enter the most holy place through our access in Christ and the fact that You, Lord Jesus, You are our advocate. And You are standing in our stead. That with that boldness, Lord, we hear this morning as You call us to draw near to You. Knowing that we are cleansed and purified because of what You've done. We pray, Lord, that You would help us to hold on. Hold on unswervingly to the hope we profess, not because we are faithful, but because You are faithful. And Lord, I pray this morning for each and every one of us here that You would teach us to spur one another on, to encourage one another as we see the day approaching, that we would encourage one another to love and good deeds, encourage one another to come together, to truly stand in relationship as You've called us to love You with all our hearts and love our neighbor as we love ourselves, that we would love one another enough, Lord, to share our lives together, to encourage one another as we see the day approaching. Lord, I pray that here in 2020, You would help us as You have ministered this to this congregation in Rome, that this morning You would make that a reality in our hearts, that You would teach us Your ways. And You would help us to hold on to this boldness, this knowledge, as we live according to Your will and purpose. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen.